It's been 20 years since the World Wide Web was created, and every aspect of our lives has been touched by this digital revolution.
Tim Berners-Lee is someone who invented something of unbelievable power.
I think the web has humanity connected.
Human civilization as a whole is now witnessing the connection of people everywhere on Earth through this web.
But what are the consequences of this extraordinary new access to information and people? Caught up in the instant connections of the web, few of us pause to wonder what it's doing to us. What is the effect on our relationships? Is the web even changing how we think?
Whether we realize it or not, through the web, we are all participating in an extraordinary and unprecedented experiment for humankind, the outcome of which is far from certain.
The great fear is that this revolution is making our senses and imagination dependent on screens, shifting us from the real world to the virtual.
It's a world that has no consequences. It's a world dominated by senses. So why do you need cognition? Why do you need meaning? Why do you need metaphor?
Is it going to bring us a different, better life, or is it going to bring us a different style of communication? That's, you know, I ask that question, I don't have the answer.
We worry that our kids are being sucked into a superficial online culture. Are they, for better or for worse, evolving from Homo sapiens into some sort of Homo interneticus?
A lot of this is a kind of middle-aged, middle-class panic about the web. They're panicked by the future. They're panicked by what they think children are doing.
I'm going to plunge into the fear and the hype to find out whether the web really is trivializing our relationships and rotting our brains. At its heart, this is about what makes us us, and whether the web distorts or enriches our very humanity.
This is the Gutenberg Bible, the printed manuscript that revolutionized society by taking information from the few and giving it to the many. This book irrevocably transformed Western civilization.
When Gutenberg invented the printing press, few of his contemporaries could have predicted the consequences. They thought it was just about churning out a lot of books. But the new media, the printed word, unshackled people from old ways of thinking and fueled the Renaissance. 500 years on, the web seems to be another great leap forward in how we think.
Its characteristics mimic some of those in the ecosystem of the printing press, in that the entry barriers for individuals are extremely low. And the role of ideas, knowledge, information is central.
It makes it much easier for information to be distributed much more quickly and to be copied much more easily, which the printing press did. But it's fundamentally different in that it also makes it possible for anyone to create information. So I think it's probably even more important than the printing press.
Over just 20 years, we've seen how the web is transforming almost every aspect of our outward lives. Its huge impact on culture, politics, and business. But we've yet to understand its deeper impact on our psychology. The first place to look for answers is the place where people use the web more than anywhere else.
If we are to see the web's revolutionary effects on human beings, then we should find them here. This is the most wired nation on Earth, South Korea.
It's In this digitally enhanced country, the web can be accessed virtually anywhere. South Korea's fiber optic cabling has 10 times quicker download speeds than the broadband that we have in Britain. 62% of Korean 3 to 5 year olds regularly use the internet, spending over 8 hours every week online. Surveys suggest this is approximately twice the exposure of British 5 year olds.
It's the young people that the South Koreans are most concerned about. Sped into the digital age and surrounded by high tech since they've been in nappies, they command the headlines for all the wrong reasons.
Koreans are increasingly worried about internet addiction. Their government's own figures reveal this affects up to 210,000 children, many spending up to 18 hours every day online. 80% of those afflicted need medication. 20% have to be admitted to hospital. I'm going to meet Mr. Ko, the government's key advisor on what's become a growing problem.
What are the symptoms of internet addiction?
If they don't use the internet, they feel anxious and unstable. They don't feel satisfied. Their friends don't talk to them anymore. And a lot of friction builds up with their relationship with their parents. And those are the consequences of too much internet use. In Korea, there were cases of people using the internet for 18 hours a day.
Korea may seem to be an extreme case, but it does show that the web's effect on our psychology can't be dismissed. And it offers us a glimpse of what might be our future.
The experiences that Korea is facing as a country with internet addiction are experiences that countries like US will face in 3 to 5 years.
The fear for coming generations extends well beyond South Korea. Back in Britain, the ultimate skeptic is the neuroscientist Susan Greenfield. She tirelessly voices her concern about how the web may be distorting children's sense of reality.
When a child is in the real world, even if it's a real world of a doll's house, this is a world where your doll might break, someone might stamp on your toy soldier. So you're learning that actions have consequences. So imagine you're a young person on a computer. It is a world where there's a strong premium on hearing and vision, on strong sensation. There is a triumph of the senses over the meaning. If you give a human brain an environment where actions don't have consequences, if you give that brain an environment that is just literal, where there is no significance, might it not be the case that that brain stays in a infantilized state? When I talk to parents and people individually, I've yet to meet someone who's disagreed with me. Everyone seems to feel a kind of uneasy fear and a poorly articulated worry that they can't really put into words, but nonetheless, they feel there's something that needs to be done.
Susan Greenfield represents the most extreme view. But across Britain, there's unease that children are growing up only knowing life online. That this is a generation consumed by the web.
I have friends and family who are struggling with their children over new technologies. Even the most technologically savvy amongst them find it strange that their kids are more comfortable in front of the screen than they are. Now, I happen to visit many of the same sites that their kids are on, and while I've got used to them, I do still feel a bit like a tourist. I'm constantly amazed at what Generation Web can do with new technology. And so I'm going to go find out what living with Generation Web is really like.
Parents across the country need no introduction to this familiar scene.
Their lives are completely centered around their computers.
I chat to friends and like do comments and stuff.
Usually Facebooks and Hotmail and stuff.
The kids come home and are on Facebook while they're having their first cup of tea.
You can communicate with people and you can look into their lives and stuff.
When I was young, we didn't even have a home telephone.
Can you imagine life without the web?
No.
I think it would be like removing her arm if you took her Facebook site away from her.
What do you think life was like before the web?
Really boring. Yeah.
What do you think people did?
Read books.
By the time Generation Web reached adulthood, they'll have spent 10,000 hours online, and a huge proportion of those will have been spent on online social networks.
For the first time on television, using a data sample of 8 million people, we can reveal how far the UK population has been sucked into the orbit of the online social networks. The size of each of these web planets represents the number of visits it receives over each month. There's Bebo for the early teens, MySpace for the music lovers, but the biggest of them all is Facebook. According to Facebook, 350 million people worldwide have Facebook accounts. If it were a country, it would be the third largest, behind China and India. Britain is becoming a Facebook nation. There are 23 million active Facebook users. That's one in three of us. And that's right across the country. The Facebook capital of Great Britain is Sunderland. More than half of UK Facebook members log on daily, on average for an hour every time. It's so pervasive that Facebook has become the main target of parents' angst.
People my age, mid-40s and up, are wringing their hands right over what kids are doing, teens are doing on Facebook. As if we would not have done those things had Facebook existed when we were young.
How dare these children now not suffer the way I did? They should be having the kind of life I did, made to read, made to do this. They should not have this freedom, this access. Or if they do, while I can approve of it, I ought to suggest that it's dangerous, that it's going to go wrong.
The key criticism of Facebook is that it makes friendship meaningless, and that undermines society. The label of friendship is just as easily attained by lifelong buddies as it is by total strangers hoarding connections. How true is this? To find out more, we need to understand why Facebook became so popular.
On the 24th of May, 2007, just 10 days after his 23rd birthday, Mark Zuckerberg shuffled into this hall and explained the secret of Facebook's triumphant success.
Today, together, we're going to start a movement. At Facebook, we're pushing to make the world a more open place. And we do this by
Zuckerberg's aim was that Facebook would become the destination to connect to friends and share information, text, photos, or social events. All that you need to do is sign up, create a profile, find your mates, and have them agree to become your Facebook friend. In this way, each Facebook member carves out their own group of friends, all within the larger network.
You'll see that what we're building is a massive network of real connections between people through which information can flow more efficiently than it really ever has in the past. And it's changing the way the world works.
But to change the way the world works, or putting it a bit more cynically, to build up marketing potential, Facebook needs to attract a huge number of users, What Facebook is trying to achieve is something called a network effect. This is a term coined 100 years ago by American telephone industrialist Theodore Vail.
This is the essence of what Theodore Vail outlined. If you have a telephone, just one, it's pretty useless, because you can pick it up, but there's nobody on the other side. There's no one to make a connection with. But if you add another telephone, add another, and another, and another, and another, this guy can talk with this guy, who can talk with this guy, who can talk with this guy, and so on, and so on. The more phones you have connected, the more benefits for the individual users, because the user has more possibilities of people to connect with. And the more people that they can connect with, the more other people will want to join. The system becomes self-sustaining and self-fulfilling. It's as simple as that.
So the power and value of Facebook increases by the number of friends it connects.
Many of these things are a sort of scale leads to scale. That is, if your friends are on it, you go on it. You don't do some objective evaluation of this one is better in this way and that one's better in that way. You know, it's like, why is the phone, you know, with its dial, why did that catch on? Well, critical mass eventually becomes the very big thing. You know, for a while, Facebook forced you to be friends with somebody if they wanted to be friends with you. And that, you know, that didn't happen to work for me because I was getting 10,000 friends requests a day.
People have the experience of having thousands of friends, right? Well, no one really has thousands of friends. It's either the word thousands or the word friends has to be struck out for that sentence to make any sense.
We've seen how Facebook needs volume. The problem is the commodity it wants to accumulate is human relationships. So what does that mean for those relationships? What does it mean to have 10,000 friends? Could a Facebook friend be something as trivial, cheap, and disposable as fast food? Worth no more than a burger?
Seriously, in 2009, a well-known fast food chain created a page on Facebook that offered the chance of a free Whopper for people who defriended 10 of their Facebook friends. In less than 2 weeks, the love of a Whopper proved stronger than 233,906 friendships.
This brazen marketing stunt surprisingly seems to reveal something fascinating about the value of our Facebook friends.
The underlying issue was, you're on here, we're all on this Facebook, we all love it, it's fun, great, but like, what's the point?
Steve Schiff was one of thousands of Facebook users who decided to trade in his online friends for a grilled piece of meat in a bun.
How do you choose which to get rid of first?
To be honest with you, it was incredibly easy. Okay. I mean, it was not that tough to find 10 people that I really didn't need to have that online connection with. This isn't something that's happening in real life, so let's just cut to the chase, let's cut our losses, let's go get our free burgers, and everybody wins.
So if we're willing to get rid of friends for a burger, does that mean social networks are changing the face of friendships in the 21st century? Or are there some immutable aspects of human friendship that Facebook can't change? I need to find out more about the evolution of relationships itself. I'm meeting the World Authority on Primate Groups, Oxford Professor Robin Dunbar.
Can you talk me through what's going on here? What's the social life of a primate group about?
It's all about social bonding, personalized relationships between individuals. Primates live in a really intensely social world. They spend a lot of time grooming each other. That sort of gives them the sense of bonding. The problem with grooming is it's a one-on-one activity. It just sets an upper limit on the size of groups in the end. So the most social species really only have average group sizes around 50 to 60 in primates.
In 1992, Dunbar came up with a formula that predicts the upper limit to the number of bonds any primate like us can ever have. And it's proved so reliable that it's become known as the Dunbar number.
We sort of plugged human brain sizes into the same equation, and it gives this number of 150. And sure enough, that turns up all over the place in human communities. It turns up in the military, it turns up in average village sizes, in the Doomsday Book, 1087 AD, it turns up in hunter-gatherer communities.
So what does the Dunbar number mean for the Facebook generation, Homo Interneticus? Has Facebook actually changed the upper limits of friendship previously set by nature? When Facebook's in-house sociologists analyzed all active networks, they found that, sure enough, nature is playing out online. The reality is that the average Facebook member currently has well below Dunbar's upper limit of 150. In fact, the number of Facebook friends they interact with on a daily basis is surprisingly small, typically only 5 or 6.
So while you can claim you have this huge network of people you know in some vague sense, most of those relationships I wouldn't call relationships, you know, they're voyeurs.
So through the Dunbar number, we've found that Facebook's drive for network effect isn't changing our relationships. For me, there's something deeper going on, beyond this superficial issue of numbers. The point about Facebook is that it does something else to our relationships. It puts them in a constant loop of digital information. To understand what that means, we need to go back to the very origins of the phrase in the loop and some important science developed in the Second World War.
The enemy again and again broke through the coastal defenses.
Night after night, the brave anti-aircraft gunners stood by their posts and tried in vain to shoot down the German bombers. British military scientists realized quickly that they were facing a grave problem.
The problem that the anti-aircraft gunners had was that while the radar could spot the planes and the gunners could fire at them, they still missed the target. It would be an American mathematician, Norbert Wiener, who would provide the answer.
When Wiener heard what was facing the British gunners, he decided to come up with a solution that tackled the problem in a completely different way.
Wiener asked a simple question. When we walk, why don't we fall over? Wiener argued that what keeps us upright is a constant loop of information to and from the brain, a loop of action and reaction that allows us to predict future action. So Wiener saw the gunner, his gun, the plane, and the pilot not as separate entities, but all embedded in the same loop of continuous feedback. Only through thinking in this way, linking human and machine together as one, could the gunners successfully hit their targets. One of the big innovations of Facebook is to apply this constant action and reaction to friendship.
In fact, I believe that they are key in understanding how our online relationships have transformed forever.
What Facebook pioneered before anyone else was status updates, fed between friends in real time. But at the beginning, it wasn't like that. Back in 2004, it was a simple college student website.
Legend has it that one night after a bad date, Mark came back and hacked into the student databases to create a website for rating all of the women on campus. 2 hours later, 80% of the student population had voted, crashing the entire student computer servers.
Mark was the type of person who was always, you know, thinking of technical solutions to social problems.
Seeing the demand for connection, Zuckerberg started a new venture, Facebook.
I built the first version of Facebook in a couple of weeks in my dorm room at Harvard. And I built it just because I wanted the people around me, the students at Harvard, to be able to share information with each other and stay connected a little bit better. I emailed a few of my friends, and they emailed a few of their friends. And within a few days, I think thousands of people were on it at Harvard.
All of us, particularly students caught in the social whirl of college life, crave news and gossip about our friends. But Zuckerberg realized that while the web made information available, people didn't always know it was there.
The problem was, browsing Facebook was like poking your head into somebody's room every time you wanted to find out what they were doing. You had to go to your friends' pages every day, or you missed something crucial that they posted. And if you missed something crucial, then you didn't respond. And if you didn't respond, then your friend thought nobody was watching. And what's the point in bragging if nobody cares?
Let's get fired up!
What changed everything is what Zuckerberg did next. He completed the loop of information on Facebook with something he called newsfeed. It meant that anything you posted on your site was instantly broadcast to all of your friends and vice versa. They didn't have to go looking at your site. All updates came to them.
We launched the product at midnight. We were convinced that people were going to love it. And we thought, you know, this is the kind of thing that could change the web.
It all seems so normal now, but at the time, Facebook users hated it. They saw it as an appalling intrusion into their lives, a terrible wrench from the Facebook that they were used to.
First thing I saw on the top was that someone had broken up with someone. And so when I saw those things, I was really just put into shock. It's like, that's so much stuff broadcasting. And then I realized that all of my stuff was being broadcast the same way too, and I don't know if I didn't really want that.
As soon as we launched the product, we started looking at the feedback coming in from our users, and it was universally bad. It was, I want my homepage back, I don't like this, please turn it off. I was emailed by almost everybody I knew on Facebook to say, why did you do this to us? It was personal. And right before we were leaving, I think we were called and told that there were security guards coming because there was going to be a protest outside. This was hours after we had launched it.
I decided to make a protest against it and created a group called Students Against Facebook Newsfeed. By third or fourth day at its apex, it was at 750,000 people in the group.
But Zuckerberg stuck to his guns. He was determined that Facebook users would live life in the loop.
Within a few days, I mean, we could see in our stats already that just the amount of page views that people were doing and the amount of engagement that they had in the site was going up, because what they were coming to the site to do was see what their friends were doing on a day-to-day basis, and this just made it so much easier to do that.
It's this culture of real-time updating and not the numbers of friends that's the big shift in all of our relationships. Constant status updates, this being in the online loop, has dragged the web into a new age, inspiring many imitators, most famously Twitter. But more importantly, what does a shift mean for you and me as we live our daily lives? I'm going to meet Sherry Turkle, an eminent clinical psychologist who's been studying our relationship with technology for 20 years. She's actively researching how the web's feedback loops challenge our sense of who we are.
I think you've started to get almost a new personality type. It moves from, I have a feeling, I want to make a call, to I want to have a feeling, I need to make a call. There's a sense in which you almost need the validation and the support of the community to in fact feel the feeling in the first place. Bringing other people into the loop of feeling your feeling, this is very seductive.
So as a recipient of all of this information, how do you think this is affecting me?
You start to want to hide. I cannot live the BlackBerry version of my life. I cannot be, read, know all of the places and spaces and feelings and the Facebook and the, my life is more than I can live. We're no longer nourished, but consumed in some way by what we've created.
I genuinely believe that we co-evolve with our tools, and most of our networked tools are, you know, our smartphones where we can check emails, desktop computers, laptops. They encourage us, because it's so convenient, to consume lots of information in little snippets.
We recently crossed the 1 billion view mark per day that we're serving. And we're also receiving close to 24 hours of video every minute on the site, which is a phenomenal amount of data.
In my life, it's increasingly rare that I have time of my own. Time to think. I have a Twitter account and several blogs to maintain, plus my Facebook status updates, my photo diary, my video blogs, and my podcast that I have to record. And that's the content that I create. There's also the content that I consume, not least of which are the emails that are at my inbox and all the messages on my answering machine. I was away for a week, and I had 283 emails that I had to go through.
Living in the loop, Homo Interneticus appears to be slowly drowning in a rising sea of information. But there's an even deeper change. The architecture of the web seems to encourage us to use our brains in a whole new way to digest the abundance of information. Here at MIT in Boston, 60 years ago, one scientist had an extraordinary vision of the future. How technology and the mind might work together. Vannevar Bush was involved in many of the great scientific advances of the 20th century. From designing some of the world's first computers to the development of the atom bomb. In 1945, he published an article that foretold our digital age. As we may think.
This is Bush's original article, and with great insight, he described all of today's problems with information overload.
At heart, he was focusing on the same problem that I'm grappling with in these archives.
I'm searching through all these files associated with Bush. And they're labeled Vannevar Bush, A through B, C through D, photographs, correspondence, etc. But the irony is, this isn't how Bush thought our brains worked. For example, when he thought about his Aunt Susie, he didn't think about all of the people that he knew whose names began with S. He thought about where he was when he last saw her, how she did her hair, what she smelled like, how she held her fingers in front of her when she talked, that kind of thing, and so on until he built up a picture of her. In other words, he didn't think our minds were linear. He thought they worked through association.
Bush put on the table the problem. He said, here is the scientist. Imagine our scientist. He has before him the human record. In other words, all the things which science has decided in its collective wisdom are true. How is he going to manage to work effectively with the knowledge which includes all that stuff?
Bush believed working in this associative fashion would open up the library of human knowledge to us all liberating our minds from the constraints of linear thinking. Almost half a century later, it was this concept of linking information that was at the heart of Tim Berners-Lee's data retrieval system he called the World Wide Web.
The brain's good at doing those things, first just finding those coincidences and then building on them to find the pattern.
Berners-Lee built into the design of the web what were called hyperlinks, the ability to leap from one piece of information to another. But the question is whether hyperlinked associative thinking is good for us. In mirroring the way the brain functions, darting from subject to subject in a click, does this make us lazy and easily distracted?
I think science shows us that our brain wants to be distracted. And what the web does, by bombarding us with stimuli and with information, it really plays to that aspect of our brain. It keeps our brain hopping and jumping and unable to concentrate.
The internet simply reflects who we are. So our inability to concentrate, our focus on real time, the fact that we're obsessed one week with Michael Jackson, the next week with Twitter, the week after with terrorism, simply reflects that inability to concentrate.
When you grow up expecting to be able to find information at a moment's notice, what does it do to your ability to internalize information?
We used to be trained in the discipline of reading and writing at length. Now the generation raised on the web's associative links seem unable to face the rigors of such linear thinking, even, it turns out, at our top universities.
What I notice about students from the first day I see them when they arrive at university is that they ask nervously, what do we have to read? And when they're told the first thing they have to read is a book, they all now groan, which they didn't used to do 5 or 10 years ago. And you say, why are you groaning? And they say, it's a book, how long is it?
Just take your own doctor. Would you be happy if your doctor simply skimmed the abstracts of Lancet and all the major databases and never read anything in detail? How happy would you be?
I still think that books are at the heart of what it means to be educated and to try and educate. And I think that the generation of students that I teach see books as peripheral.
I happen to think that long-form reading is very important because you can learn things from long-form that you could never learn from short form. You can't read Remains of the Day and not come away with a better understanding of life regret. And those are things that you can only get in sort of book-length reading sessions.
But are these just the grumblings of an older generation? Beyond anecdotes, can we find any evidence that the web is really changing how we think? At University College London, Professor David Nicholas was the first academic to systematically study people's online behavior by analyzing millions of anonymous data records. In one survey, he found that 40% of people never revisit the same web page, that they only view up to 3 pages from the thousands that are available online.
The really big surprise was that people seem to be skipping over the virtual landscape. They were popping in from sites, looking at 1 or 2 pages, going to another site, looking at 1 or 2 pages, and then going on. Nobody seemed to be staying anywhere for very long.
Professor David Nicholas's study suggests that the web's hyperlinked network of information is converting us from thinking linearly into thinking associatively.
These two types of thinking can be termed fox and hedgehog.
Foxes are people that embrace all kinds of ideas, like the wisdom of the crowd, bounce from here and there and pick things up, and that's how they acquire their knowledge. And then there are hedgehogs. Hedgehogs like one big idea. They repeat, they go back to the same source. These people like the peer-evaluated environment because they're certain of that. And these people represent quite a different group of people.
Now we want to find out whether the younger generations are becoming more fox-like than hedgehog. So we've joined forces with UCL in a unique experiment that you too can take part in online to find out which species of web animal you are. Our aim is to discover the impact the web is having on our brains.
Is this test a genuine first?
Absolute first, a global first. Nobody's ever done this before. Nobody even knows what's going to come out of it.
To give us a first indication, we've brought together 100 people who represent different ages and genders. Some use the web rarely, others all the time.
Look at your screen, concentrate on what you have to do, click start, and that game will begin.
We are especially interested in the 12 and 18-year-old age groups because their brains have been formed only knowing life with the web. How does their behavior compare to people who rarely use the web and to serial users like myself?
You've got to look at the pictures, you've got to look at the numbers, you've got to look at the letters, you've got to make a decision. Is it an odd number? Is it an even number? Is it a vowel? Is it a consonant? It's a bit too much for my brain.
The results from our initial survey of 100 volunteers seem to confirm what many suspect. Generation Web seemed to display more fox-like behavior. They answered their questions after looking at half the number of web pages and only spending 1/6 of the time viewing the information than their elders did. So it seems pretty clear to me that, for good or ill, the younger generation is being remolded by the web. Facebook's feedback loops are revolutionizing how they relate. There's empirical evidence now that information overload and associative thinking may be reshaping how they think. For many, this seems to be a bleak prospect, young people bouncing and flitting through a thoughtless, throwaway virtual world. But are we being too harsh? Are we failing to spot something valuable about this new culture?
We go on singing the old song of fragmentation and alienation because every society always looks at the preceding age while living in a new current one, never sees the age it's living in.
You might be surprised to learn that that was recorded in the 1960s, and the person who was speaking was the Canadian maverick thinker Marshall McLuhan.
In 1968, McLuhan took up a year's professorship in New York. It was the perfect destination for him as he was enthralled by the hustle and bustle of modern life. He positively welcomed the kind of future that the web has now given us.
McLuhan thought that the coming of the electronic age would speed up the movement of information, injecting new life into the mundane mechanical era. He thought that the rules, the regulations, the beliefs of the 19th century would be overturned as we were forced to dance to the faster rhythm of the electronic information loop.
In the 1960s, he told a story of how, in the future, we'll all be connected in real time, and our messages will just sort of flow as if we were sitting next to each other. You know, as if we were right there. And that's just a profound thing to say in 1968.
I'm off to visit web entrepreneur Jonah Peretti, who believes McLuhan's dreams are now playing out in Homo Interneticus. That spoof cat videos and dancing men are actually evidence of a sophisticated, interactive culture at work.
McLuhan realized that people always judge new media by the standards of old media. So in this case, you see that the internet is all about the social relationships and the network, but people still judge it as if it was static content. And so you look at it and say, oh, this is a silly cat video, and judge it as content, instead of saying, oh, this was something that one person created in their garage, that three other people collaborated on and added to, that was now being used to satirize a political campaign, and that it's part of a web of creativity and a network of sharing that is actually more interesting and important than the media itself.
I think a lot of people would look at so much of what goes on online, you know, the
the memes, the silliness, the kittens that are stuffed inside glass vases and all these kinds of things that literally get sent around everywhere as a distraction, as a bit of a waste of time, as actually not particularly worthwhile. But at the same time, you're seeing it as something that has a sophistication, aren't you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, when you think about things that are a waste of time, think about the average sitcom, right? Or the average Hollywood movie. You know, you sit there passively. There's not really much to do except just passively consume this media that's for the lowest common denominator. When you look at viral culture, what you see is people much more engaged. You know, so you mentioned kittens and glasses. The Bonsai Kitten project was a fake site that made it look like instructions for how to make bonsai kittens, where you put them in jars and they get funny shapes and you can make your very own. It was a total prank. And the person who created it launched it by telling a bunch of animal rights activists about it and said, "You'll love this." Of course, he knew that they would freak out and hate it and send it all around. But then as a consumer, when you see that, you have to go through a sophisticated thought process where you say, it's a joke, I think it's funny and I like it and I'm gonna send it to people, or it's a joke and I think it's still offensive and I'm gonna fight it and organize, and it breaks people into different groups of how they feel about it, and they can react and interact with the media and become part of the story where the people are actually powering the media that's spreading around and changing and evolving. Once you figure out some of the principles of how things spread online, how do you make something that when people see it, they want to share it or pass it along or bring more people in? It can work for silly things or for serious things.
The apparently superficial culture of young people on the web can have a serious side and a direct impact on the real world. One of the most powerful examples for me can be seen in how Generation Web is re-engaging with politics.
What is required of us now is a new era of responsibility, a recognition on the part of every American that we have duties to ourselves, our nation, and the world.
I made the decision in February of 2007, pretty early on, to take I leave from Facebook and go and work full-time for the Obama campaign. The campaign from the start was really interested in running a bottoms-up grassroots initiative, which happened to intersect directly with everything that was happening online in 2006, 2007, 2008.
Barack Obama!
The young users of YouTube, Facebook, MySpace, and Twitter became central to the campaign.
We had members of Congress on Twitter. We had protesters organizing through Twitter outside. We had the president on Twitter using it to campaign. And we had everyone in the country, well, not everyone, but a lot of folks across the country using Twitter to express their opinions on the hot topics. So we sort of had like the entire spectrum.
During the election year, Obama had 3 million Facebook friends. And studies show a third of all under 30-year-olds used social networking to communicate their politics. That figure was negligible 4 years earlier. Two-thirds watched political videos online. A quarter forwarded them on or remixed the material. 'Cause I got a crush on Obama, I'll wait till 2008.
What we were able to do was figure out how people could do it their way. And that there was a really it's a groundswell of energy and enthusiasm, both in terms of fundraising, but also in terms of time spent volunteering for the campaign.
America, we have come so far. We have seen so much, but there's so much more to do.
Election night in Chicago was something I think anybody who was there will have to say will never happen again.
It was indescribable. I mean, it was a really important moment for the country above everything else. We were all just so emboldened by the fact that not only had we done it, but we'd done it differently. And that made everything all the more powerful.
The technology of the web, with its feedback loops and associative connections, appears to have attracted young people to politics on a scale that hasn't been seen for generations. All around the world, as we've seen, young people, for better or worse, are harnessing the power of the web to fight their causes. From the uprising in Iran, to the young Russian hackers who claim to have launched cyber war against Estonia, they recognize the power of the web to connect and collaborate. For many, this is a very positive development. Web guru Stephen Johnson believes ultimately collaboration, a kind of pooling of intelligence allowed by the web, has always been a key driver of human progress.
One of the things about ideas that's so interesting is we have this myth that they come to people in a kind of eureka moment where somebody's, you know, sitting in their study and suddenly they think, aha, I understand gravity, or I understand, you know, how to build a nuclear reactor. But in fact, what tends to happen much more than we realize is that ideas are much more collaborative.
If you look at the history of invention, what you find is that inventions are dramatically disproportionately centered in urban areas. One of the great things about cities is they're filled with these, you know, public spaces like a coffee shop where people come together who might have some shared interests but come from different backgrounds. They work for different companies, or they are artists meeting writers or filmmakers. And in that kind of point of convergence, they sit around and they talk and they share ideas, and it becomes a kind of connected space. So the web is, in some sense, this kind of virtual version of what cities have historically done. You have people connected in a way that was never possible before. And, you know, part of it is this basic kind of principle built into the architecture of the web. The web is, at its core, a platform for linking things.
When you look at a city with its teeming masses of people, each of whom have their own dreams, desires, and expectations, it shouldn't work, but it does. So could it be that the essence of what makes a city truly great, the gossip, the connections, the serendipity, could also work on the web?
I believe that at best, the web can be like an exciting, innovative metropolis that eventually could benefit the younger generations. Earlier, we saw that some people view South Korea, the most wired nation on Earth, as a nightmarish vision of web addiction. But along with the downsides come hidden benefits. As young South Koreans grow up in their supercharged digital world, they regularly top the world's education league tables. I'm meeting the president of the Korean National Information Society Agency, who claims that Korean children's advanced achievement is not due only to a great education system, but because from an early age, they interact and work together on the web.
Korea is now leading country in terms of mathematics and science and other areas. I think it is influenced by this kind of environment of the high penetration of internet.
This generation is growing up with the web. Mm-hmm. It's growing up with it as part of their education system. Mm-hmm. What hopes and what expectations do you have for the world when they grow up?
They will be more intelligent compared with us.
So I look forward to that.
Because they now recognize the importance of communication and helping each other for solving some problem. Collective intelligence is now basic to their instinct. I hope it is helpful for some evolution of mankind in the world.
Every kid starts with an incredible amount of curiosity. You know, why are some materials strong? Why are some materials weak? Well, you know, I asked that when I was a kid, and nobody could answer. Now, you know, my son will get the answers and want to ask more questions. So I think it's a huge change.
Here
human civilization as a whole is now witnessing the connection of people everywhere on Earth through this web in ways that actually do mimic the growth of a human brain. And the analogy is imperfect, but it's also real. We are seeing the emergence of a global brain.
In this series, we've seen how important it is to study the impact of the web on all our lives. The web appears to give us all a voice and to level society. But we've seen that the ongoing cycle of this virtual revolution is also encouraging mega brands that track and trade us, and governments that can spin and spy as never before.
The way in which small groups of elites dominate in cultural, political, and economic terms, it reflects our values, our narcissism, our views, our obsessions.
Even as it opens up extraordinary new possibilities, the web is weighed down by the limits of our imagination, our desire to profit and control. The web holds up a mirror to human nature, the good and the bad. Yet in this film, we've seen the new generation not just reflected in the web, but maybe evolving with it.
My hope is that the web will eventually show us new horizons, liberate humanity, and change human nature for the better.
All this great stuff that's emerging in social media is people trying to find new, interesting ways to communicate, become more efficient, become more engaged, become more informed. And I think it leads ultimately to having more empathy.
The web isn't going to, you know, solve disease, right, or solve poverty, but what it does is it makes it so that people can share information more effectively and know what's going on out there, right? And when people are better informed, then people can make better decisions.
Hopefully social change happens gently. The sort of thing which the internet brings by connecting people is openness and understanding of other people's ideas on a good day. So I hope we have a lot of those good days.
We have the knowledge of the ages gathered for us to browse in our pockets. And if we seriously think that's a bad thing, if we seriously think that's something we should turn our backs on or sniff at, then we really deserve a slapping. This is astounding technology, and we should just take a moment to celebrate the power and the reach that it gives us across time and across ideas and across continents, both past, future, and present, to connect with people.
Perhaps the most amazing thing about this revolution is we've seen all of this profound change in just 20 years. This isn't the end. It's merely the beginning. Don't forget to go online and take part in our web behavior test. With your help, this major experiment will discover the impact the web is having on our brains. As well as fox and hedgehog behavior, we've identified other key web species. What kind of web animal are you? Visit bbc.co.uk/virtual revolution, where you can also follow the links to the Open University for more from those reshaping the web and the world. And that was the last part of the virtual revolution. Next tonight, with men's giant slalom, we're back to Vancouver for more Winter Olympics action.